following Four Aces production is for mature audiences only. Listener discretion is highly advised.
Yes, 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 yes. We are here. We are here. We are here. Welcome to the inaugural episode of the Cheap Pop Podcast, starring myself, Double K, and Alpha over here. What's up, bro? Ready, ready. Now, for those of you who know, yes, I used to be a part of the show called The Raw Impact Unleashed. We had a 5-year run, but decided to kind of bring it to a close. Well, you know me, I can't stop talking wrestling, man. I can't stop talking pop culture. So we brought Alpha in, and we're going to keep this ball rolling with a brand new kind of format to all of this. Whereas The Raw Impact Unleashed, we talk primarily wrestling, and we talked other things at various times, depending on our mood. This one, we're going to kind of focus on all pop culture and pro wrestling as a kind of a center point of the pop culture world, because whether people like to admit it or not, pro wrestling is a major, major part of pop culture. But we're going to be talking everything from comic books to comic book movies, to Marvel, to DC, to television shows, just various things that go on in pop culture. And we're going to kick this off by talking about a movie that came out a little while ago, but is still kind of sticking in the minds of everybody right now when it comes to Marvel fandom, and that is Spider-Man Far From Home. It was the last movie, I believe, of Phase 3. And effectively the first movie of Phase 4. Endgame was kind of the ending to all of that, to the Infinity Saga. Spider-Man Far From Home is kind of like just a little bit of tail, like, okay, this is kind of what happened afterwards, and then you can move into Phase 4. I've yet to find out what the first movie, they didn't release a release slate, they just told us the movies that were coming, at Comic-Con, and we'll get to that in a second. But as far as Far From Home goes, Alpha, why don't you go ahead and kick us off with your thoughts? You've seen the movie, of course, we both have. Kick us off with some of your thoughts on the movie as far as how it kind of fit into everything that we've seen so far, all the other, 20-plus movies that we've seen so far. Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. Sorry. I got to unmute you. Sorry. Start that over again. My bad, guys. You guys couldn't hear him. I could hear him in my ears, so I thought y'all could hear him. All right. Go ahead.
All right. Sorry about that. But no, absolutely. Far From Home is, I didn't know how I feel about it going in. I thought it was a little bit weird looking at it in the way that, you know, there's this big, massive movie in Endgame, but the official ending is Far From Home. And I didn't know how I would feel about that, but it fit in really well into the gap of everything. But above all else, even if you're not up to date on Infinity War and Endgame and all that jazz, the movie itself is just a really good movie. Tom Holland does a really good job of portraying Spider-Man. And I'm not going to spoil anything, but at the end, the guy who had played J. Jonah Jameson in the original Spider-Man movies, the Tobey Maguire movies, he comes in and he reprises his role, and it's absolutely fantastic.
And this is historical. They didn't like that, not to cut you off, but that's historical, because this is the first time that Marvel Studios has reused anybody from the old series in their same role in the newer movies in the MCU. I forget the actor's name.
Oh yeah, exactly.
Well,
it's very big.
Jameson, yeah. But go ahead. Sorry.
No, yeah, that was a very big thing. Like, no, he pops up on the screen and it was immediate. Like, no, they actually did it. They really pulled that. Mm-hmm. And most of it is, of course, like, you know, nobody else is going to be able to play J. Jonah Jameson like that man.
Yes.
But, like, above all else, every one of the new characters that they brought in like that were all really, really done well. Like, Mysterio, I wasn't sure how they do it, because they had said that going into it they were going to have their own little take on it.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure about Jake Gyllenhaal especially playing him, but he knocked it out of the park.
Yeah, he did. And
he did.
I'm gonna state this right now, because I'm going to get into some spoilers. So if you have not seen Spider-Man Far From Home, fast forward past this part And we're going to probably be talking about it for about the next 5-10 minutes. So fast forward past this part if you haven't seen and you don't want spoilers. But I thought they did a really good job with Jake Gyllenhaal in the sense that, I'll be honest with you, up until the big reveal of him as the villain, I had no clue. Like, I was all behind Mysterio, and I was behind, so all right, let's go Spider-Man, or what did they call him, the monkey?
Oh, fucking Night Monkey.
The Night Monkey. I was all behind Night Monkey and everything, you know, all the way up until when they revealed him. And then I was talking to a friend of mine about this the other day. The way that they brought back in all of those old characters dating back even to the first Iron Man movie. You know, like that really blew my mind as well. Because to be honest with you, if they hadn't shown me that flashback scene of that dude talking to what's his name in the first Iron Man, I would have had no clue who that dude was. I truly would.
Oh,
I would not have.
No, they did not forget, and that they really pulled that out of left field. Because it's like, of course, like going into it, I'm a huge Spider-Man fan, so I really pinned down what happens with Mysterio. I know what happens. You know, he comes in. Everything about Mysterio is supposed to be that it's fake, and then he fakes his death, and he comes back way later.
Yeah.
But I had a feeling they were going to pull that, but no, they did it really well, like, mm-hmm. with the way they did it, especially with that whole bar scene.
Oh, yeah.
And then the way he walks out, and the whole place just disintegrates. You're just like, hold up. No,
what?
They did it.
Dude. And like you said, I give a lot of credit to the writers, because it was a classic Spider-Man flick. From the sense of the tone, where the laughs were placed, how he was just awkward in every possible way. Like you said, Tom Holland is an amazing actor in how he portrays the Spider-Man character. But one of the things that I actually enjoyed the most out of all of it was the interactions between him and MJ. Like they did that whole awkward relationship really, really well. Like, and even up to their little awkward kiss towards the end of the movie, like everything was done very, very well between the two of them. But I have to give a nod. I have to give a nod to the Marvel writers for this. From day one, from Iron Man on, they have encapsulated what Tony Stark is all about.
Mm.
Not just with Robert Downey Jr. as the actor who played him, but I'm just talking about the way they wrote him, you know, as the arrogant, you know, super genius, you know, basically Sheldon Cooper on crack. I don't know if any of you guys watched The Big Bang Theory, but but basically Sheldon Cooper on crack, you know, in the way that they played him. But I think nothing showed that more than what he named the system after his death.
Mm.
Now, it's a small line, and you really kind of got to an extent, be paying attention in the moment. But when Tom Holland first puts on those glasses, when Peter Parker first puts on the glasses, and he calls for Edith, and he's like, Edith, what does Edith stand for? And then she repeats back to him, Mr. Stark named me Edith. For the acronym, Even Dead, I'm the Hero. If that's not the most Tony Stark thing ever, I don't know what is.
Like, I don't know about you, that's one of the rawest lines that has been said in like the last 10 years of cinema history, dude. Like, that is quotable.
It is, man. Even dead, I'm the hero. Like you just can't do any better than that. So bravo to the Marvel writers for doing a great job with Tony Stark. Even after the character has been eliminated from the Marvel Cinematic Universe, you still have him giving us great one-liners from beginning to end. So bravo to them.
Honestly.
Yeah. And just the last thing we'll kind of touch on is the last two cutscenes. And once again, if you have not seen the movie and you want this to remain a surprise, skip past this part. The first cutscene kind of blew my mind more than the second one did. The fact that it was Nick Fury was on a spaceship and it wasn't really Nick Fury in the movie, that's pretty much par for the course with Nick Fury. Like there's all he's like M. Night Shyamalan. There's always some kind of twist. Okay.
M. Night Shyamalan. I've never heard that.
You know, but, you know, so there's always some kind of twist with him. But what did get me was the big reveal when they brought back J. Jonah Jameson of Jake Gyllenhaal revealing who Spider-Man was to the rest of the world. Like, that one was like, okay, now where do we go from here? Like, I get it that they're kind of going along the similar lines of what they did with Iron Man. Because, you know, at the end of the first Iron Man movie, Tony Stark reveals that he's Iron Man. I've never seen it. I don't remember in the comic books it coming out that Peter Parker was Spider-Man.
It did multiple times, but it depends on which timeline we're talking about here.
Okay.
Because... You know how they are. They retcon everything they do not too long after they do it.
Right.
But it's dependent on which timeline we're talking about. But most of the time it isn't like that. The one that immediately comes to mind is when Civil War happened and Peter Parker himself got a Spider-Man. But I like what they're doing, though, because they're really taking it in their own direction while still sticking to the source material. It doesn't feel like they're straying away from it too far. And I really like that.
And DC, take note. Because that is what happens when you have really good writers who write for you, is they know how to make things cohesive. They know how to use things from the comic books without necessarily destroying the actual storyline that they were in. All right, so let's get to this. So let's get to some of these Comic-Con announcements. All right, so Comic-Con took place a couple of weeks
ago. Oh, yeah.
You know, and I'm pretty sure most of y'all, if you're listening to this podcast, probably followed on Sci-Fi Network, just like I did, or some of y'all might have went to the Comic-Con. But the biggest talk for me, at least, coming out were the announcements of Marvel for Phase 4. They did not announce any release dates, but they did announce quite a few movies and shows. Let's start with the movies. The biggest thing to come out of it is, oh my God, I cannot pronounce this guy's name. I'll just call him Ali, who just happens to be the cousin of a guy who we'll have on the show here in the next few episodes. My friend of mine, Jamil, who grew up in Oakland as well as Ali, but he will be playing Blade. I'm kind of happy and sad about this all at the same time. happy, sad, and happy. Happy because...
Wait, let me guess. All
right.
Is the downside that we're not going to see Denzel as Blade?
No. as much as I love Denzel, no. No. What my biggest disappointment was, I'll start off with the bad news. My biggest disappointment is that we won't see Wesley Snipes as the lead character. But... That was kind of tempered with the fact that Marvel did announce that they are trying to look for a role for Snipes in the movie. So he will be in it, but he won't be Blade. Maybe he'll be Old Man Blade. You know,
if I see that, do you have any idea how hard I will pop, dude? I will. Oh my God.
it will put me over, because to me that would be the better way to do it. But if you're gonna start Blade over, if you're gonna be rebooting the series, then you kind of can't have Old Man Blade, because technically Ali's playing the same exact Blade character that Wesley Snipes played. But we'll see how they do it. The Marvel writers have done very well with everything else. I don't expect this to be any different.
I have faith.
Yes. But Ali will be playing Blade. For those of you who don't remember him or who don't know the actor by name, if you watched the...
Luke Cage.
Yeah, Luke Cage series on Netflix, he was the villain in the first season, the one that's killed by Alfre Woodard. Cottonmouth was his name in the series. And so I remember it led to one of my favorite memes coming out of Comic-Con, which was Mike Coulter sitting there like, how is it my show gets canceled? And on the bottom part of the meme, he's looking all confused. And Cottonmouth gets upgraded to playing Blade. I'm like, well, that's just how it is. And that was also...
Oh, go ahead. Oh, no, that was a reaction. Like, yeah. No, that's harsh, bro. That's yeah. tough.
and to be even more sucky when it comes to those old Netflix series, Marvel has already announced that for all the Defenders series, all the Defenders individual series will be moved over to Disney Plus, but none of the actors will be retained. So Mike Coulter will no longer be playing Luke Cage. Dude that played Mike Murdock will not be playing Mike Murdock. The Iron Fist guy was the guy that played Danny Rand won't be playing Danny Rand. The one that I hope they do keep is please keep Vincent D'Onofrio as Kingpin. Please. There's been a better Kingpin ever.
Like, don't get me wrong. Like, I really loved Michael Clark Duncan in that terrible Daredevil movie.
Yeah.
But like, seeing as how that is no longer an option, that man is the best you're going to get for Kingpin.
Yes.
It's in my opinion, it's the same as John Bernthal as Punisher. Like,
yes.
Between the two of them, you're not going to get two people that are more better for those two roles.
Exactly. And here's what gets me. And here's what gets me the most, that hurts me the most about it. All right, so let me get this straight. So they also announced that, yes, for those of you who wanted to know, Falcon will be carrying the shield in Falcon and the Winter Soldier. So he will be carrying it, but he won't be wearing the Captain America garb. He'll still be in the Falcon garb. He'll just have the shield.
No, he has his own suit that comes with it, like in the comics. There's a whole new suit.
Awesome. So you got Falcon and Winter Soldier, who are both being played by the same characters, you know, Anthony Mackie and Sebastian Stan for the small screen. You got WandaVision, which, by the way, gets my vote for the stupidest name of any television show ever. But
horrible. Jesus. Just, oh, my God.
The one thing Marvel does wrong. You bring in Elizabeth, God damn it, I can't remember her name. It's not Shu. Elizabeth, forget what her name is, but the girl that played the Scarlet Witch on the big screen is going to be playing her on the strong screen. What's his name's coming back? Bethany is coming back as Vision, you know, for the small screen. But yet you can't bring over the Netflix guys to continue their roles when you're continuing the series on Disney Plus? Come on now.
Like, yeah, not even that, but it's just like, you know how much cooler it would feel to see that it feels like more of a crossover that way. It feels a lot less like artificial. I don't know about you. Like, it just feels cooler that way to think that they would be crossing over from, it feels like two universes merging that way. And now there feels like I'm getting that taken away from me.
Thank you. Because the fact of the matter is that, and we stated this a little bit earlier with Tom Holland, when you find somebody that's so perfect to play a character, don't go away from that. That's the mistake that DC has a tendency to make. They find somebody who's perfect for playing the character, and then they choose somebody else to play them in on the big screen. They do it in the exact reverse. Like, I'm sorry, nobody but Stephen Amell should be playing Oliver Queen on the big screen. Period.
That's how I feel. That's how I feel about Flash, dude. I don't think anybody other than Grant Gustin can pull that off like that.
No, they can't. And so it highly disappoints me that they're going with different actors on the big screen for that. You know, Batman's never shown up on the small screen, so you can use whoever you want for Batman. You know, the Superman. I like Tyler Holcomb, but okay. You can give me a different Superman. I'm okay with that. But at the end of the day, man, the characters like The Flash, they've been playing these characters for so long. Like, nobody but Melissa Benoit should be playing Supergirl. Like, it's,
there we go.
You know, like, these are just stalwart characters. And you did the same thing with the Netflix series when you had great characters. I admit, yes, okay. If you really want to get technical, the guy that they got to play Danny Rand shouldn't have been playing Danny Rand, considering the fact that I guess Danny Rand in the comics is half Asian, and they pretty much got a white guy to play him.
Yeah, no, the whole thing about Danny Rand is that, you know, he's an American kid that was raised by monks, and then it gets real convoluted, especially when you consider the different versions of Danny Rand that have come through, and it gets real weird. But no, yeah, you're right, though. From day one, like, I don't think he was even he should have even been chosen. But like that's a whole different topic.
Yeah, we'll discuss that later. And even the girl that they got to play Jessica Jones, I can't see anybody else playing the character, and I haven't even watched a single episode of the series. Just watching her in the Defenders series that they did, when they all came together, there ain't nobody better to play Jessica Jones. So it's like, why are you going to go out and find all these new people to play these roles when you already had the perfect people for them? But that's what Marvel wants to do.
Exactly, but like not even that, but I feel like it'd be funner to work it inward, like especially when you look at characters like The Flash, where like the whole idea is that he's popping through this dimension and that one, and he's time hopping, and he's multiverse, he's breaking things, and he's just shoving dimensions around like that. I don't know, it would be cooler to just have Grant Gustin pop up in the mainline DCU.
Yep.
It would make sense, they could work that in, and especially with Marvel, in Far From Home, actually, going back to that, they talked about the multiverses and all that, and they're. I think I've heard that they're going to put a bigger focus on that. You could work in the past characters like J. Jonah Jameson or the characters like Luke Cage with the idea of the multiverse like that.
Right.
There's a lot of ways that they can go about it, but instead they're just hitting the reset button.
On just about everything. And let's see. Now, some of the other announcements that came out of Comic-Con as far as Marvel go was they did announce the Eternals, which this is kind of like old and new news at the same time. Like, we had heard that they were coming out with an Eternals movie like 3-4 months ago, and Angelina Jolie was going to be playing one of the main characters, which, by the way, while I was at, I believe it was Far From Home? Yeah, while we were at Far From Home, saw the trailer for the new Maleficent movie, and I never seen the first one, but I might go, they might get my money on the second one. It looks pretty badass. So Angelina Jolie is going to be playing Medusa in the new Eternals. They announced a couple other people, but I can't remember the actors' names, that will also be playing in it. So that movie's due out, I believe, like 2021. They announced the Blade movie. They announced Black Panther 2.
Wait. Did you mean the Inhumans or the Eternals?
The Eternals.
Okay, I was just making sure.
They did that eight episode like miniseries that was kind of like bleh.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
That flopped real nicely.
and after that flop, they pretty much decided that at this point in time they're not going to do the Inhumans as a thing. Now, see, what pissed me off is that what they could have done is instead of doing that stupid ass eight episode miniseries, you could have extended the life of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. by working the Inhuman storyline in the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., considering it was already set up with Daisy getting her powers and everything else like that. Like, you could have easily worked the Inhumans into that and then kept them going as characters in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. You know what I'm saying?
There's a lot of options that they could have worked into Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. like that. There was a lot of different options, but the Inhumans was a go-to option, especially with how much people have been talking about it. It really boomed over the last 3 years, the interest in the Inhumans.
So, but, oh well, we got what we got. It wasn't the best thing. It wasn't the worst thing Marvel's ever done, but it wasn't nearly even close to halfway to the best thing that they've ever done. So it is what it is, but we won't be getting Inhumans anytime soon. But they also announced one of the other big controversial announcements that they made was, and the reason why it was controversial blows my mind, was that Natalie Portman will be reprising her role as Jane Foster in the fourth Thor movie, Love and Thunder. And Jane Foster will officially be taking the mantle of Thor from Odin's son, and she will be wielding Mohinder. So I read an article the other day, and I'll say this. The reason why I did not use the term female Thor is because I read an article the other day that made sense. What is written on the side of Mohinder? Whoever wields this should have the power of the God of Thunder. God of Thunder is Thor, right? So literally,
right.
whoever wields Mohinder is Thor. Odinson just happens to be the guy that it was given to. So the article basically opened up by saying, stop calling her female Thor. She's not female Thor. She's just Thor. And I was like, okay, you know what? You got a solid point there. So I've taken it and made a conscious effort to no longer refer to Natalie Portman as the female Thor and just to refer to her as Thor. But there's been a big uproar in the comic book online universe about her getting the role, which baffles me. But for two reasons, first and foremost, because A, it's been done in the comic books. So this is not something new. This is not something that's being done because of PC culture or blah, 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 blah. This was done in the comic books. And if there's anybody that's worthy and that should hold, be able to wield Mohinder, it's Jane Foster. Let's be real.
Can I add something real quick?
Sure.
I'm really not about, you know, the whole bullhorning things into media for that sort of PC culture. And I'm real in on that, but I absolutely adore the new Thor. And when the new comic came out, I read it and it was instantaneous. Like, no, this isn't about that. It has a really good story. It is, it focuses on the idea of her cancer and how she fights that and how she helps people in opposition to that.
Right.
It isn't like characters like Riri Williams when she took over the mantle of Iron Man. And it isn't like characters like Kamala Khan, where it just feels like they're bullhorning in for the sake of bullhorning it in.
Right.
It doesn't feel like that. It feels really, really authentic, and it feels really good. And in my honest opinion, it does even better for the male Thor, because what they did with that in the comics was that while she took over the mantle of Thor and had her own story, it gave Thor more and more development, because he became unworthy to wield Mjolnir.
Right.
It made him have to like work up to being the god of thunder again, and it gave him a lot of good character development. But no, yeah, normally I would be like, I'd be really iffy about this and how they do it, but it's very clear that it isn't like that at all, and it's definitely more than accurate to the comics.
Yeah. And that is what I hope at the end of the day people see it as, instead of trying to see it as something that's shoehorned. Because the fact of the matter is, if you really have been watching the previous Thor movies, they've been building to this.
Yes.
You know, they've been building to this. So to an extent, it makes sense that would be the next step. I'm just happy to see Natalie Portman back on the big screen. I've missed her since she was in the Star Wars movies. I'm a mark for Natalie Portman. What can I say? she's by far one of my favorites. But yeah, so congratulations to her. Congratulations to Marvel on a lot of their big announcements. Another big announcement that came out of Comic-Con, and this isn't on the running sheet, just so you know, was the announcement of the Jay and Silent Bob reboot. Now, this has me extremely excited, because I am a huge fan of Kevin Smith in general, and especially a huge fan of the Jay and Silent Bob characters. So the fact that they're giving them another movie, love it. Can't wait to see it. Saw the trailer for it. All over it. Going to be in the theater day one, sitting in the front seat of the theater, watching it, doing that thing.
Oh, you don't even know. I'm going to be sitting there like a kid in a candy store, dude. I'm going to be getting in my seat. I'm so ready for that.
I love those
movies.
Let me tell you, listeners, this much. If you have not watched a Kevin Smith movie, start with Clerks, the original Clerks. If you can't get into Clerks and find it funny, don't bother watching another movie. I'm just going to say that right now. If you cannot get into Clerks, because Clerks is by far one of Kevin Smith's best works. And so if you can't get into that one, you're most likely not going to be able to get into his other movies. But for me, if I had to rank them, if I had to give a top five, it would go Clerks, then Chasing Amy, then Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back, then Dogma, and then you could really toss in any of the other ones in that fifth slot. And I would be okay with it. But those four, for sure.
Right. He just pumps out comedic masterpieces. They aren't the type of movies where it's like event one after another, keeping things interesting like that. They're a lot more focused on the script and how he words things and how he focuses on the jokes like that. And it's a masterpiece, in my opinion, the way that he can work words that way.
To make a tie back to one of my favorite shows that I just did earlier as well, it kind of reminds me of the Big Bang Theory. He speaks at an intelligent level, but it's dumbed down enough to where anybody can understand it. You know what I'm saying? Like you take a movie like Dogma, there is a huge overarching you know, message to that movie. But it's scattered amongst all these little fart jokes and, you know, and all the rest of the stuff that goes on in the middle of Dogma and these little conversations that happen, you know, and but there is a huge overarching message. And don't get me wrong. Everybody else in the world fell in love with Ben Affleck and Matt Damon on Good Will Hunting. I fell in love with Ben Affleck and Matt Damon in Dogma. And
that's a good answer. I'm with that.
You know, like Ben Affleck, like one of his best scenes in any movie I've ever seen him in is the diatribe he goes off on when he's going off on I believe Bartleby is the name of is Matt Damon's character's name, but he's going off on Bartleby and he's just laying into him about how he's so pissed off at God because God favored the humans over the angels and blah, blah, blah. Go see the movie. You'll understand what I'm talking about, but it's some of the best acting that I've ever seen Ben Affleck do. And definitely Kevin Smith, follow him, watch him, listen to his podcast as well as ours. He's a great producer. I wrote a side note real quick, just a sidetrack. When I for one of my first college classes, it said take a business. I'm taking some classes to get my BS in business management. It said take a business that you feel has failed and tell me how you would make it better. Oh, okay. I jumped all over it. I chose the DC Cinematic Universe. And I was like, first thing I do is fire everybody. I was like, then I'd bring in Joss Whedon to run everything. Kind of like how they brought in Kevin Feige to run everything for Marvel. Then I would hire Kevin Smith to direct like the first five movies. To direct and write the first five movies. Because then you would have everything set up with cohesion and everything else. Then what you do is you bring in the writers from the TV shows to work with Kevin Smith to create the cinematic universe. Then, like we talked about earlier, you take all your actors from the existing TV shows and you have them reprise their roles on the big screen. Boom. DC Universe is fixed. Now you go back and wipe clean everything. Okay, the only movie I would keep from prior to when I started saying this is Wonder Woman. That's it. Everything else goes, and we're starting over. And then other than that, you build from there. Justice League, gone. Batman v Superman, in the trash can. It's all gone.
Retcon. Hit the red button. Out of here. I don't blame you, honestly, though. It's like they really dropped the ball with some of the biggest names in entertainment.
Yeah.
And it's become hard to look at because it's like, I know damn well there's so much better material that they could be pumping out with what they have to work with.
Yep.
And everybody and their mom always just beats down on the DC universe. And I don't absolutely hate it. I don't loathe it. There's definitely a lot worse, but it's like, it sucks because you see it and you know damn well that it could be a lot better with what they have to work with.
Yep. And that's it. Oh, and the last thing, Zack Snyder would not be allowed on any set ever that has DC on it. Zack Snyder can go himself, okay?
Yeah, like, no Zack Snyder, none.
If your name is Zack, you ain't allowed on the set. Just go, okay?
If your it rhymes with name Zack, is Zack, you ain't allowed. Not even. Fucking great.
If your mama named you Snyder, sorry. Too bad. Can't come on the set.
God.
But yeah. But we'll transition that into talking a little bit about DC's big crossover event this year. Now, mind you, every year DC gets more and more ambitious with their crossovers. The first year it was just kind of one big villain and they kind of did a crossover. And then a couple of other years they've kind of had like they introduced Supergirl with the crossover event into the Arrowverse a couple of years back. Last year they did Elseworlds, which was kind of a major undertaking, which, by the way, let me state this again, now that we're in the proper context. I stated this on Raw Impact Unleashed, but let me state it again. The fact that of how they tie DC Legends into this year's thing without actually making them a part of the crossover was one of the best writing jobs I've ever seen. And for those of you who don't know, during the crossover event, there's a mention, like, it's once again, it's just a subtle line that passes by. Forget who says it to who, but it's a subtle line there where they pass by where somebody goes, "Did you contact the legend?" "Yeah, they said that they're not interested in this year," and they just kind of go on, right? And then on that same week's Legends of Tomorrow, they come back on the boat, and it's Haywood, Captain, or was it Captain Steele? Yeah, Captain Steele is sitting there, and they're like, "Did we get any messages or anything?" He's like, yeah, the other superheroes called about the crossover, but I told them hard pass." Right? Fast forward to the season finale for DC's Legends, and they're going through a storyline where they need, like, some popular and known faces. And so they themselves get in costume as Arrow, Flash, and Supergirl. And as they're shooting the commercial, one of the characters from Legends says, "Well, don't we know them? Why couldn't we just call them ourselves and have them come do it for us?" And Laura Lance looks at Captain Steele. She goes, "We did call them, and they looked at, and they told us hard pass." And I was just like, "Okay, that was an excellent way to bring that full circle."
You know, 10 out of 10, right there.
Exactly. Once again, that shows where these DC writers on the TV shows are way, 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 way more advanced than what they have going on with the movie writers right now. But all that being said, the upcoming event that's coming up is going to be Crisis on Infinite Earths. It's been a long time, and I'm really old, so it's been a long time since I've read Crisis on Infinite Earths, that particular storyline. So, I'm not too familiar with it, but I'm pretty sure I'll enjoy it. I've enjoyed every other crossover. But it's going to kind of, by word has it that by the end of it all, the entire Arrowverse is going to kind of all be one universe again, minus Arrow. I guess we'll have to start calling it the Flashverse, because this is the final season of Arrow. They're only doing, I guess basically they're doing enough episodes leading up to Crisis, and then the Crisis episodes will be the Arrow series finale.
And don't remind me. I don't want to cry right now.
I know, man. It's sad to see it go. But it's had a good run. How many other comic book shows can say they lasted like 8 seasons?
Honestly, though, and 8 really good seasons at that.
Exactly.
Like consistently good seasons.
Exactly. So Crisis should, they set up Crisis with this past, with the ending of Elseworlds. They actually introduced us to Arkham and to Gotham City. For the release of Batgirl or Batwoman. I don't know what they're calling the series. I think it's Batgirl. So that should be rather interesting to see how they do. My biggest disappointment that I've found out so far, and hopefully I'm wrong, is that the Black Lightning series may be getting canceled, and most likely, even if it's not canceled, won't be a part of the Crisis series. Or won't be part of the Crisis crossover. That sucks.
That's heartbreaking. I don't like that. I'm not digging it. Because I waited for a really long time for Black Lightning to even get, like, you know, that spotlight. Because he's a really, really underground DC character that's one of the most well-written, in my opinion. He's really compelling. And the show itself is really damn good, especially when you set it alongside the other set of DC shows, too. It holds up really well.
Very well-written, very well-done, and... Okay, I was explaining this to my... I was talking about this with my mother the other day. Yes, I do talk to my mother about DC shows and comic books. She watches them all and does them all. And she actually has her own opinions about them. But Black Lightning... Okay, so Black Panther was a huge movie because of its impact as far as representation. You know, we had never really, in the history of movies, really seen Africa... represented on that level like that. You know, even Coming to America was great, but it played into a lot of stereotypes about African people, you know. But we had never really seen it represented like that. Black Panther kind of did the same thing for American black culture. You know, what Black Panther did for kind of African culture as a whole and putting it on the big stage, Black Panther has kind of done for African American culture. You know, it kind of represent what goes on in a lot of hoods and in a lot of urban neighborhoods that are primarily black. And to me, it had, I don't know why people didn't want, not to mention the fact that, let me just state this again, Tobias Well is possibly one of the best villains they have going on any comic book show ever. Like, that boy is cold.
No, he works well in making you actually hate him.
Exactly. And the fact that I give them credit. In the comic books, Tobias Well is an albino black dude. And DC went out and found an actual, real-life, albino black dude to play him. Like, that to me was just so damn cool.
And this is further impressing the whole everything that goes on behind the DC TV show workings.
Exactly.
It just further impresses me.
So I first hope that it didn't get canceled. I hope that it is coming back for a third season, even if they aren't melding it in with the rest of the Arrowverse. I hope that it definitely is coming back for a third season. But I really do wish that they would have used Crisis to tie in Black Lightning to the entire rest of the Arrowverse. You know, that would have been a nice and fun way to tie them in there. But if they don't. It sucks. Part of it I heard is also because the showrunners for Black Lightning don't want to meld their universe in with everybody else's. I'm like, but why? Like, it's worked
why?
So well. Yeah, it's worked so well. But Crisis should be good. I'm looking forward to it. Now let's go ahead and throw these rankings out there, and we'll kind of change them as the show goes on. But I would say movies, Marvel, comics, DC. Well, see, it's a tie for me with DC and Marvel because I have things that I like. Because if you look at and further show DC's dominance when it comes to TV shows, take a look at Krypton. That show is very well written, very well put together, and is a damn good show. And they did a damn good job with Lobo. I don't know if you know who, I'm pretty sure you know who Lobo is, right?
You know, I know who Lobo is.
Yeah, like they introduced Lobo in this season of Krypton, and let me just say, I was very happy with how they did it and what they did. Lobo was a badass.
Who plays him, dude? It's perfect.
Yes. So it only other person I could have seen playing him was Rob Zombie. Like let's be
honestly
real. Like look.
No, I heard that idea, and it was like, yo, like, that would be top tier. I heard the idea of like if you don't know David Bowie was originally supposed to play the Collector in the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Really? That would have been excellent. Before Benicio Del Toro got it?
Yeah, exactly. Oh. No, like, hearing that is on the same tier as that. Like, if Rob Zombie could have played Lobo, that would have been that's best case scenario. That's it. Like, there's no better than that.
Yep. Oh, and for those of you who don't know who David Bowie is but want to understand why we think he would make a perfect, go watch the movie Perfect Role for the Collector. Go watch Labyrinth. That's the movie that would really show you why he, at least in my opinion, why he would have made a perfect Collector.
In my opinion, that movie is like that is a 5-star movie. There are a few movies that I know of that are as well put together as that movie in particular.
Yes. Amen to that. Now, speaking of putting together movies, I went and saw my first Disney live-action remake.
Oh, boy.
Okay, so I went and saw The Lion King the other day.
Oh, boy.
I have to say this. The changes that they made to it, I'm okay with. And overall, I thought it was a good enough movie that it has me interested in actually going and checking out Aladdin. There were a couple of scenes that they changed. For those who don't know, they did change the scene with Scar when he performs the song Be Prepared, which is one of like the big moments in the thing. They did change that because in the original animated version, there were a lot of like Hitler nods in that scene, in those scenes, you know what I'm saying? From the way the hyenas were walking, the way he was acting, the way Scar was acting and all that. So they kind of changed that because they didn't really want to offend anybody. You know, but overall, and there were a couple of other things that they changed because obviously even CG animals, you can't get them to do what you can draw them doing. You know, so there were a couple other things that were changed because of that. But overall, all of the key songs were still there. All of the key moments were still there in the movie. Like, it was just well put together. So I can definitely... Now, this doesn't surprise me once I saw who directed it. For those of you who don't know, John Favreau, the same guy who did Iron Man 1, 2, and 3, is the guy that directed the Lion King live action movie, or CG action.
I did not know that. Okay, so yeah. that adds together pretty well. No, I did not know that.
Yeah. All right. So it was like I said, pretty well put together. I don't know how I feel about Disney live action remakes right now. Like, it sort of seems like Disney's just kind of getting bored. You know, and they're just going back and rebooting a whole bunch of and doing live actions of all their old, you know, animated movies, and not all of their old animated movies really need live action remakes. You know, but,
no, yeah. Above all else, like, I really like these movies. Like, they aren't bad movies. They aren't bad. I really didn't like the Lion King movie. I love Childish Gambino especially, so I loved the role he played. I really loved that that the same guy who had voiced Mufasa is voicing him again, that he's been around for that goddamn long.
Yeah.
And it's a really well put together movie, but I don't like the idea that they're really pumping out these live action remakes of what they've already done.
Yeah.
They've shown that, you know, when they really put the effort into it and they make up something new and original, it really goes a long way.
Yep.
It shows with movies like Frozen that came out a while ago. I use that as an example because it's one of the few newer movies that they came up with, and it knocked it out of the park, absolutely. And I love, you know, seeing movies from my childhood come back. The live action Aladdin is really good, actually. I enjoyed it. But I just don't like the idea that they're cashing off what they've already done, you know?
Yeah, no, it does. It, especially considering a place that for the better part of the past 70 years, we've consistently had new and fresh ideas. You know, like one of the big controversies over the most recent one is the big controversy over the casting for Ariel for the new Little Mermaid remake. Now, here's my one rule for Disney with all of their remakes. If you're going to redo it, fine, whatever. It's your property. I don't like it, but it is what it is. Leave the music the same and leave the music in the movie. Because without those songs, the movie is not the movie. Period. You know, and because, like, that was one of my biggest things with Aladdin is, like, I was a huge fan of the movie, but I was a bigger fan of the Aladdin soundtrack. Okay?
Oh, dude.
Like, I know pretty much every song from the Aladdin soundtrack by heart. And so, to me, that was the major thing about it is you got to keep the song the same. And in The Lion King, they did a pretty good job of keeping the music pretty much exactly the same. You know, it was just with live action instead of animation. So keep that going, and you might have me for a couple of movies. Like I said, I plan on going back and watching Aladdin. Lion King was okay. It wasn't the best movie. The animated movie was still better. But it was an okay
pretty
movie
much.
For what it was.
No, yeah, like that's how you have to look at it for me. It's like, you know, they're good movies, but they're nothing compared to the originals, and any type of remake of it just isn't going to hit the same mark at the end of the day.
Exactly. All right, so...
See, like...
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
No, you're good. Above all else, my thing is that, like, they can do what they want with the movies. They can fix them. They can change them. Of course, absolutely. Keep the songs. But don't change core elements of the movie, you know?
Right.
Don't change very important things like that. Because then at that point, is it really the movie? Exactly. If you... Have you heard what they're doing with the new Mulan movie?
I've seen the trailer. I'm interested. Once again,
okay, you shouldn't be because for what? Because there's a for the Mulan movie, there's not going to be Mushu. The dragon is gone, and all of the songs are going to be completely removed. It's literally just going to be the base movie with their own little direction of it, and I absolutely don't want to go anywhere near it.
Okay, so that will be one that I'll probably be watching on online. I'll probably be streaming that one years after it's come out because, like I said, once you take away the music, it's no longer the movie. Like, you can tell me the story all you want, but without those songs, the story just doesn't pop.
Ripping the heart out of the movie, dude.
Yep. All right, so with all that said that we've talked about for basically almost the past hour, all the announcements that we talked about from Comic-Con, let's try to narrow it down. One thing of the announcements from Comic-Con that you're looking forward to, and it doesn't necessarily have to be on our list. If there's anything else that you heard about from Comic-Con that has you excited, what's one thing from Comic-Con that you're looking forward to?
All right, so I had heard that they're going to do something with War Machine. Mm-hmm. I'm not quite sure. I had heard about it, but I'm unsure about that, so I'll say that, like, if that is true, then that's absolutely number one, because I adore War Machine and Don Cheadle as War Machine.
Okay.
But I'm not too sure about that, so I'll look into that after this. But because I'm not sure about that, I'm going to have to say Falcon and Winter Soldier.
Right,
like, okay. I adore the Falcon character and the direction that they'll be able to take with that.
Yes.
I'm really interested with it because I really like Falcon as Captain America in the comics.
Yeah.
The death of Steve Rogers and the mantle of Falcon and the relationship that they had and how they played on that was absolutely gorgeous. And I want to see how they'll be able to take that to the big screen, because they haven't dug into either of those characters too far since the Captain America movies.
Right.
And they did really well with what little time they had.
Yeah. And that's where I agree with you 100%. Like, well, in the sense of that pick is a great pick. Like, the one thing I wanted to add to that was that that Disney also did announce that basically Falcon and the Winter Soldier will pick up immediately after the events of Endgame.
Mm.
So it's going to be a continuation on of their story from Endgame on. So that definitely has me excited. But I can't necessarily say that that's what I'm most excited about. And people can say whatever they want to say about why, but I'm most excited about the Blade reboot.
Like, mm-hmm.
I've wanted Blade in the Marvel Cinematic Universe dating back to Iron Man. You know, for those of you who don't know, it was recent. Like, I want to say the past 5 years or so, Blade actually became a member of the Avengers. So in the comic book, I'm hyped to see them bring that to fruition on the big screen. You know, I'm just super juiced for that. Now, mind you, I forget the name of the character that Ryan Reynolds played, but I would love to see him reprise that role, but he's going to be retaining his role as Deadpool in the MCU moving forward. So I'll take him as Deadpool over that guy any day of the week.
Absolutely.
But that's it for us for the first half of the show. We're going to come back and get into the meat of things with wrestling and Raw, SmackDown, Extreme Rules, SummerSlam, G1, Fighter Fest, AEW announcements, all of the hottest topics that we can think of in wrestling for the second half of the show. But for right now, our voices need a break, so we're going to take a commercial break, and we'll get back with y'all right here on the 4 Aces Presents Radio Network. You are listening to the Cheap Pop Podcast, starring myself, K-Double, and Alpha.
Hey, hey.
All right.
So, what's up? Steve Finger Styles here, the host of the podcast, spelled D-A, of course. Tune in each and every week to hear what pisses me off, what angers me, what I make fun of, and of course, my crazy rants. I also have incompetent co-hosts, cool guests, and a silent producer that sucks. So what more do you need from a podcast? You can listen on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, TuneIn, SoundCloud, and the Pod Bros Network. Peace.
From the galactic depths of the comic book universe comes the Ghosts of the Stratosphere, ready to galvanize and energize your mind with the latest of comic book news and reviews. And why are you stopping me?
Yes, that's much better. Hi, this is Andy Larson for Ghosts of the Stratosphere. Join me every week along with my co-hosts Rob Stewart and Chad Smith, as well as a cavalcade of fantastic comic book guests, as we dish out heaping helpings of the greatest and latest of comic book news and reviews. New shows posted every Tuesday, with bonus shows every first Friday of the month. You can find us on iTunes and Stitcher under Ghosts of the Stratosphere, as well as on our website, www.gotstratosphere.com. Hope to see you soon, folks.
Hey guys, this is Venice, and I've got a message from a friend of mine about my favorite podcast.
It's your boy, Flavor, Flav, and Full Effect. Check this out, everybody. I want y'all to go check out TJ.
What's good, everybody? TJ Johnson here for Voice from the Underground. I am the most handsome.
Big ass.
And I'm smoking my cigar, of course.
You know what I'm saying? The Josh.
You pick me up in an Uber and a PT Cruiser, I'm calling Lyft.
Cause they be fighting the power, talking about social issues, politics, you know what I'm saying?
And we're not even that good.
Right, we're terrible. Terrible. Tangents all over the place.
And not only that, but they be keeping the fun with the sports, music, comics, and movies too.
Am I allowed to talk?
I think no, not right now.
Shut up, colonizer.
You know what I'm saying? He on Twitter at VFU Podcast. Yo, you can find them. You can find them. So check 1, 2. This is Flavor Flav. Yeah, boy.
Okay. What Flav was trying to say is check out Voice from the Underground on your favorite podcast network.
Voice from the Underground.
Interruption in progress. Now hijacking into ANS 2.0 immersion rig. Now simulating the amazing nerd show, featuring comics.
And Batman's like, you're safe here and everything, but the Joker all of a sudden pulls out a gun and shoots himself.
Movies.
People fight with lightsabers. What the hell do you want? I mean, in every one of these movies, there's a lightsaber battle.
Yeah, no problem. I'm gonna rewatch it a million times.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, give me something more.
Wrestling.
That would be awesome. Oh my god, just a monster. Fans would be like, holy, what the hell's going on? What happened to Jericho?
Horror.
It starts off like any other like home invasion type of story, and then it just goes crazy.
And more.
Hey, this is Christian.
Hey, this is Dan.
And we are the Amazing Nerd Show.
Make sure to download us on all your favorite podcast platforms.
Sorry about that, guys. Outro started running. All right, so the promos that we just heard were for some various other pop culture podcasts: Ghost of the Stratosphere, Voice from the Underground, Dub Podcast, and Amazing Nerd Show, all on the Apple Podcast, Google Podcast, et cetera, Stitcher, et cetera. So be sure to check those shows out after you finish listening to us. After. There we go. All right, man. So,
shout outs.
Yep. Let's look at it. So, first and foremost, let's do a quick moment of silence for the death of possibly one of the greatest guys to ever do it. One of the guys that helped build this business to where it is today. The one, the only, the magnificent Harley Race, who passed away at 76 just a couple of days ago. I didn't load up the bells, so we won't be ringing the bells for him this particular show. But a moment of silence for him. All right. So I'd like to share real
quick. No doubt.
Or let's take a look real quick, and then we'll kind of talk about it match by match as we go down. Actually, one match that's not listed on here, I just noticed, is that... Oh, no, there it is. Okay, so there's 10 matches scheduled for SummerSlam so far. So this is the SummerSlam lineup so far. You got Brock Lesnar versus Seth Rollins for the Universal Chip, Becky Lynch versus Natalya for the Women's Chip, Bayley versus my girl, Ember Moon for the SmackDown Women's
Chip.
The
WWE, man of culture, I see.
Yes, sir. WWE Championship, Kofi Kingston taking on Randy Orton, which is a long-time rivalry. You get for the U.S. title, you got AJ Styles taking on Ricochet. Then you also have KO versus Shane McMahon, which is one of the hottest storylines in wrestling going right now.
Hell yeah.
Let's see. Finn Balor taking on The Fiend, Bray Wyatt. Even though I personally think, and I'll just state this right now before we dig into it too much. You know what? No, I'll go down the rest of the cards, and then we'll come back to that as the first match. Miz versus Dolph Ziggler, and just recently announced on this week's SmackDown, Trish Stratus coming out of retirement for one more match to face off against Charlotte Flair. But getting back to that Finn Balor, Bray Wyatt, I know we only got a week before SummerSlam, but please tell me that Finn's going to come out as the Demon. You got to have the Demon versus the Fiend.
God.
Please.
If they don't have Demon face off with this cracked out Mr. Rogers that is now Bray Wyatt, I'm going to be so disappointed it's not even funny.
Well, okay.
Because if you remember correctly, last year we were robbed of their climax match.
Yes,
we were going to face off at TLC, and then this buttload of people got caught with meningitis, and Bray Wyatt was one of them, and we were robbed of that wonderful match that was going to come. And like, I'm really glad they picked it back up with Bray Wyatt's new goddamn wonderful character.
Well, I will say this, and I said this to somebody a while back when I was on a thread for Monday Night Raw in one of my sports groups. I like Bray Wyatt's new character. I have issues with it. I think I mentioned this to you when we did our face-to-face talk before we were setting up this show.
Mm-hmm.
It's stolen. For those of you who don't know, there's a thing. We used to advertise it on the Raw Impact Unleashed all the time. It's called Hood Slam. It takes place out of Oakland. It's a not for your kids wrestling show that takes place the first Friday of every month out in Oakland. And there's a character there by the name of Doc Atrocity. If you go look him up, you'll come to find that there are a lot of similarities between the Bray Wyatt character and his character. Not to say that there's not always similarities between wrestlers' gimmicks, but the similarities are so, so similar that the idea from WWE had to have been spawned from this particular character. And so I always have an issue when WWE chooses to take the gimmick and put their spin on it and put it on one of their guys instead of just signing the guy who's doing the gimmick down in the indies. If you like the gimmick that much, just sign the guy. It's not like you can't do it. You know, so that's my only issue. I like the Bray Wyatt. Like, Firefly Funhouse doesn't exactly rub me the right way. It's okay. But I like the Fiend character. I like Bray and his split personality characters. I truly do. I still am pissed off that they never gave him a Sister Abigail. Like, I always thought Nikki Cross should have been brought up as Sister Abigail. And she should have been put with the Wyatt family. But that was just me.
Yo, holy shit. I never thought about that. That would have been perfect.
You know, if you weren't going to do anything, evidently they had zero ideas of what to do with her with Sanity on the main roster. So you could have brought her up solo if you're going to have her run solo, and you could have had her play that character. But yeah, that's my only issue with it. Is that it's a little too similar to a character out here. And like I said, if it is spawned from that character, then if you like the character that much, you should have just signed the guy that wrestles under that character at Hood Slam, period. But I wanted The Fiend versus Bray Wyatt when he was the Eater of Worlds. Like, I wanted it way back then.
Mm-hmm.
So give it to me now. Now that Bray Wyatt's got this whacked out character that he wrestles in a mask, give me The Fiend versus Bray Wyatt now.
Don't ruin this for me, damn it.
You know, don't make me come out to Connecticut, because I'll come out there.
Don't make me go to Stanford.
You know,
I know where you're at.
Oh man,
just want my match. No,
you know, I just want one match, man. Just one spectacular match. You also had an interesting
Watch. They're going to give you the match. But it's going to be a squash match like Randy Orton versus fucking Rusev at SummerSlam last year.
Oh my God. I'm so tired. I'm so over squash matches for anybody other than guys like Braun Strowman.
Honestly.
If you're not giving me a squash match for a guy like Braun Strowman, I don't need it for anybody else. Like, Bobby Lashley doesn't need to, unless he's coming out to squash Leo Rush, Bobby Lashley doesn't need to have any squash matches. We get it. Bobby Lashley is a big guy.
Unless it's all consecutively beating the tar out of Leo Rush, I don't want it.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, if you want to give me 5 consecutive weeks of Bobby Lashley beating the tar out of Leo Rush, oh, God, I'll watch every week for that.
I'll pay for that.
Yes. I am a little bit upset that Braun Strowman's nowhere to be found on the card for SummerSlam yet. He's not in any of the championship matches. Maybe they'll pair him with somebody and he'll get a tag team title shot.
They just really need to give him something, dude. Honestly, something.
You know one thing I thought they were going to do, and I'm kind of mad that they didn't, is I thought with that whole Samoan Summit thing that we were leading to, like I was saying to my fiance's son, as soon as they announced the Samoan Summit, I said, and your next Raw Tag Team or SmackDown Tag Team Champions, Roman Reigns and Samoa Joe. I'd go for it.
Why? Fuck me. Why was that never thought of? I'm angry.
I'm like, you had the perfect build-up to it over the past few weeks, that the Samoa Summit could have been where the Shane McMahon comes out and goes, okay, you guys hate each other so much, now we're going to put you in a tag team match together. You know?
And then it worked.
And it worked.
And then it worked, you know? They could have done something with that. Fuck, what? Oh, my God, that's genius.
You know? Man, I'm telling you, WWE, hire me. And give me my mother wrestling checks. Give them to me. So many great ideas.
I'm in need of some Vince McMahon sized checks.
You know, like because really right now Roman's not doing anything. You're not doing shit with Samoa Joe. You know, it's like, man, come on.
Oh, man. You're not gonna put a you know what they could do though. If not that, at least like you know what they could do. Like, I hate the idea of, like, rehashing things, but you remember, like, Jesus, that's over 10 years ago now. I'm going to cry. 13 to 14 years ago or so when Joe and Angle were having that hellacious feud.
Yeah.
Where it culminized with them just, like, having this capital on the whole damn company. Which by the end, they just had every single title on both of their shoulders.
Yes.
Something that power trip sort of with Roman and Joe, I'd be really interested in that.
It's funny that you use that specific saying because, like I said, the last time we saw that in WWE was the two-man power trip.
Exactly.
Stone Cold Steve Austin and Triple H. For those of you who may be too young to remember that, that was one of the greatest runs for both of those characters as heels ever in their careers.
It ended way too quickly.
Because I believe what? At one point, Austin held the WWE Championship, Triple H held the IC title, and they both held the tag team titles.
And they were just top shit, dude. They were just like, they were the most powerful men in the company, and it looked gorgeous. Like, the look that they had with that was, I cannot describe it, dude.
It's the only way that I find it acceptable to put all your straps on one or two guys. Is if you're running that
honestly.
Type of a storyline. I have this feeling that we're going to end up having a New Day versus the OC feud at some point in the near future.
Mm.
Because only reason I say that is because, okay, it may look like Kofi's about to lose to Randy Orton, and there's a lot of people that make it want. But spoiler alert, for those of you who don't live in the Sacramento area, Hell in a Cell will be in Sacramento on October 6th. And yes, I'm still planning on buying my tickets. Just got to get rent paid on Sunday. Planning on buying them on Monday. Okay. All of the announcements for Hell in a Cell have announced two matchups. I forget what the other matchup was. But the first matchup that stands out and that's pertinent to this conversation is WWE Champion Kofi Kingston will be defending his WWE Championship at Hell in a Cell. So that would be me to incline to believe that Kofi's not going to be dropping the belt come SummerSlam.
Shot themselves in the foot.
Yeah. You know, so that's a spoiler alert for you there. Now, has WWE done this and still went on ahead and did a title change anyway? Yes, they've done that before, but it doesn't happen that often.
Not likely.
So I expect Kofi to still hold the belt come October. So that kind of spoils that particular match. And we will do predictions. What, SummerSlam next Sunday, right?
Yes.
So, yes, we will be doing predictions when we record next week for SummerSlam.
Perfect.
That'll be a part of that show. But I'm actually super excited about the Kofi matchup, because the last time that Kofi and Randy Orton had a feud, it was one of my favorite feuds of the year. Like, it's
you remember that? That?
Oh, yeah.
I sure do, dude. That was nice.
Kofi destroying Randy Orton's that Viper NASCAR car that was made was amazing. Mm-hmm. You know, like, that was Kofi. Oh, just one more thing. Mm-hmm. Not to jump back and forth, but on the Joe subject, I've been seeing a lot of people posting a picture of some dude from AEW talking about the best heel in the business. Y'all better recognize and put some respect on Samoa Joe's name. Joe is the best heel going right now in any company. And he is completely underutilized in WWE.
Just look at any promo he does, and it'll just, that pops out instantly.
Exactly.
Watch the way he fucking talks and the way he commands respect that way, dude. And I'll tell you, that is the biggest heel right now. And I have faith that he's going to be for a very long time, because he runs with it. He is it.
If you want to see one of the best heel promos ever cut, check out two of them. Check out the one the week before he faced Samoa Joe at, I believe, Extreme Rules. Before Kofi faced Samoa Joe at Extreme Rules. That particular promo, and then the promo that he cut on Monday Night Raw on the reunion show right before Roman Reigns came out. And if you can't see that Joe is the best heel in the business, then I'm sorry. You have something wrong with you as to what a heel is.
That, and he did a promo last year, the final SmackDown before Money in the Bank. And that's the one that me and you talk about a lot. But no, it's the one where he comes out and he just firing on all cylinders, chopping everybody's head off with everything he says. And he's just rolling with it. No stops in between. And it's perfect. It shows that he's just a warrior. That's just what Joe is. And he runs with it.
And I'll put it to you like this. Promo-wise, Joe even made Roman Reigns look good. Like, let's be real.
Honestly.
That promo that was cut between the two of them, like, Joe even made Roman Reigns look good. That's how good of a heel Joe is that Joe made Roman Reigns look good. And I've never been a big fan of Roman Reigns promos, ever. The best promo I ever thought he, and people consider me cold for saying this, but the best promo I've ever seen him cut was the shoot promo that he did with the when he told everybody he had cancer. And that was only because he was being real. You know, like you, and you could see that he was being real.
Like the one where it was just like, I'm Joe, and the way he ran with it, no, it just felt real, and that was it.
Yep.
And that's the closest we've ever got to Roman Reigns being good on the mic.
Yeah, pretty much.
All of those promos he did on Brock,
yep.
Those are horrible. I'm sorry, but like, watching those was painful.
No, and I'm having a
feeling.
Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. No, go ahead.
No, I'm having a feeling to believe that they're going off script with Kevin Owens, too. I don't believe that they're scripting Kevin Owens.
Oh, my God.
Promos. Like, I believe that he's shooting.
No, did you see the way he was talking to fucking Shane on that one where he stood up on the table and it was just mic after mic? No, my mom burst into my room and she was like, did you see that promo that Kevin Owens just put out?
It was the closest thing to the pipe bomb promo as anything out there. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but Vince pretty much handed Punk an open mic, told him to go out there and say what you want to say. Like, Vince pissed, but Vince was aware that Punk was about to get real, that this was going to be a shoot promo.
And look how it worked out.
Now, Kevin Owens, what happened with Kevin Owens was close in a sense of intensity, but it didn't quite live up to the pipe bomb. But then, you know, that hadn't been done really before in wrestling. You know, when CM Punk did it. So there's something to be said about being the first to do it. You know, and the impact that has. Mm-hmm. But what Kevin Owens did was he did truly, and what got a lot of the fans behind him is he did truly speak for a lot of the fans. A lot of us don't want to see more Shane. A lot of us.
A lot of us?
Yeah.
Well, 99% of us.
Yes. Now, don't get me wrong. I was happy when Shane came back. I was. Because I thought Shane would be able to inject some more youthful ideas, and maybe he could push Vince back from the main stage a little bit, but that didn't happen. Shane took over. Mm-hmm. Shane became Triple H. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if it.
Wow.
I know you're old enough to remember it, but I don't know if a lot of other people are old enough to remember when Triple H and Stephanie basically ran the company, and Triple H put himself in every championship match possible. You know, like.
It was not fun. It was really boring. It came out and he came out and did the same promo, you know, I'm the game, the King of Kings. This is what I do 15 years plus. And it was just that over and over again. And it becomes that kind of stale again with Shane.
Now, what I will say is, though, is that him doing that allowed us to get a Stone Cold like character out of it, which is the positive.
Very true.
You know what I'm saying? Like, them spinning basically Kevin Owens as the new age Stone Cold works. Because Kevin Owens, like a Damian Sandow, I'm trying to remember who more recently I've said that about, where they just know how to take a character and run with it. And Kevin Owens is proving this particular character, he knows how to take it and run with it.
I'm sorry, but like that man was not called Mr. Wrestling for no reason.
Yes. Yes, when he was Kevin Steen, baby.
Panda Pile Driver, baby. I miss him so much.
For those of you who don't know, that was his name on the independent circuits before he came to WWE and became Kevin Owens. He was Kevin Steen. Like the man knows how to cut a promo. He always has, which is why it baffles me why they don't put a mic in his hand more often.
Always. Yeah, have you seen what he did when he was NXT champion?
Yes.
The run that he had with that belt was downright legendary. I'm sorry, but it was historic in my opinion. I'm sorry.
If you want to give me a heel stable, give me KO. Well, now he's a baby face, but give me KO as a heel. Give me Joe as a heel. Give me Ziggler as a heel in that stable. I don't like Ziggler by himself, but if you give me him in that stable as a heel, a man of little words that has a big kick, I can roll with that. Okay?
I never thought about that, but I can see that.
Yeah.
I can see that.
You don't put a mic in his hand that often, but he gets out there and he does shit. You know, he does impressive shit.
Let him be the silent force.
Exactly. And then you throw Strowman in there as a heel. You give me that stable, and they can dominate the WWE.
Shit, Main Event Mafia Part 2?
Oh, I would love it. Oh, God, would I love to see that. Man, you
exactly.
don't know how bad. When Sting signed with WWE, you don't know how bad I wanted to see the Main Event Mafia come back.
Like, dude, you don't even know, honestly. Like when Joe signed and Kurt came back, it was instantaneous. Like please, just once.
Like TNA is a defunct company. You can use the Main Event Mafia.
Like they already bought their whole library, dude. You can buy the namesake. Come on.
Exactly. You know, like it's all just like because let's be real. You got Booker T. You got Samoa Joe there. What, Booker T, Samoa Joe? Pretty much everybody's there except for Scott Steiner.
Nash. Scott Steiner, Nash.
Didn't Nash just show up on Raw Reunion?
Okay, wait. Hold up. I'm sorry. I meant Nash, like, in ring.
Okay, yeah, in ring. Yeah, as far as wrestling, yes. But he could be a valet. He could be a manager. You know what I'm saying? He could be somebody.
No, though, he could. No, even as that would be fucking perfect. That would be top tier.
Ooh. You know, I'm like, give me that Main Event Mafia, like, oh. Like, because I always felt like Main Event Mafia was like the corporation, but done better.
Honestly. No, it was the corporation from 2001, but done to a T.
Yes. You know, and even you could even bring Sting in, because he doesn't have to wrestle or take bumps. You could bring Sting in the same way you brought in Kevin Nash as a manager.
Like with the way they're have you seen who's managing Sean Spears now on the Indies? Sean Spears, Ty Dillinger. No, they have Tully Blanchard managing him now. Yeah, and it looks really good in my opinion, and like that sort of relationship of like that old grizzled veteran. If they can run something like that with Sting with someone like Dolph Ziggler or something like that in a main event mafia situation, that would be top tier.
Oh man, I'm telling you, WWE, hire us, put us at the head of the creative room, and then tell Vince to get the fuck out and let us have full control, and we will have your product rolling. Trust me.
Give me a pen and some paper. Let's do this.
All right, so. Another horrible thing to come out of Extreme Rules was Brock Lesnar cashing in the Money in the Bank contract to win the Universal Championship. So now we get another month. Well, okay. I have to give credit where credit is due. Brock won the belt 3 weeks ago, and he's shown up on two out of the three Raws since he won the belt. So at least he's making regular appearances now.
Somewhat-ish. It's better than before, though.
Yes. Yeah, that's better than showing up once every 6 months, winning the belt and then disappearing for 3 months. So jeez, congratulations to Brock on showing up, you know, in this build-up to SummerSlam. But I don't like him holding the belt. I just don't. You can utilize him as a monster to come in and beat people's asses and all that stuff, but stop giving him straps. Seriously.
No, that's the only issue I have, like, I adore Brock. I love Brock. I love Brock, dude. He's so damn badass. Just the way he moves and the fact that his whole gimmick is, let's not fight. Let me just throw this dude around until he stops moving.
Yes.
Like that's just raw as hell. I'm sorry, but it's awesome and I love it. But they put the strap on him, and as a wrestling fan, it's like that strap loses all believability and all value.
Yep. Because it's hardly ever there. Like I said.
Exactly.
Like, his destruction of Seth Rollins on Monday Night Raw this week, bravo. A-plus
job. Oh, my
job.
God. But, dude, for the first time, I cringed watching something WWE-related, dude. Like, when he F5'd Seth and Seth bounced off of the stretcher, that looked bad. And, I was like, wait, no, I actually felt that.
Like, Seth ain't going to be seen for a couple of weeks. I don't care how tough you are. That hurt. That's going to leave you
sad. No, the sound it made, dude, did you hear it?
yes, no, it did. Like, when it hit the ground, it went crack. Like, I thought I heard a rib crack or something.
That solid crunch, that was real. That was very real.
And I love the way they threw that brawl between Samoa Joe and Roman Reigns just right there into the middle of all that. Like, just randomly you have this brawl come working its way through with the Usos and the club and the OC and Samoa Joe and Roman Reigns. It was like, okay, where the hell did that come from? All right, now bye. Back to
it actually feels like it actually feels like a cohesive universe or something now, you know?
But that's what you get.
It's almost like that's how it's supposed to be.
But that's what you get when you allow two geniuses like Bischoff and Heyman to run the shows individually.
Oh, right. No, yeah, I was gonna bring that up real quick. Last time we talked about it, you know, it was just when those two had been announced.
Yeah.
And I don't know about you, but I've seen an improvement, like a real genuine improvement in the product since.
Yeah, no, I have. And not just in the product, but in the cohesiveness of the storytelling. You know, everybody seems to be doing something specific. They're not just kind of there. You know, everybody serves a purpose. Like the 24/7 championship.
God. Dude, I'm sorry. I love that angle. Everything about what Drake Maverick is doing is fucking golden. I could watch that for days. I'm sorry. I love it.
Oh, man. Like, it's... The fact that they announced that R-Truth, like this title has been around for what? A little over a month? Didn't they announce it after the June pay-per-view? Or was it after WrestleMania?
Yeah. I think it was a little after WrestleMania, I believe.
All right.
I think so.
So we've been dealing with this title for 2 months, and R-Truth is already a 10-time, probably eventually an 11-time 24/7 champion.
put some respect on the name of fucking Ron Killings.
You know, shit, by the time he's done, he's gonna outdo Ric Flair for most championships held in one championship, or most times held in one championship.
He won't touch Raven though. He won't touch Raven's 27 hardcore championship reigns.
No, he won't. Oh man, but by far everything about that storyline has just been plain awesome. I didn't like, I'll be honest with you, this is the first time where they went in an angle that I didn't like. I don't like the Maria Kanellis angle. I just don't.
Yep. Nobody likes that. Not even going to hold it back. Nobody likes what they're doing with Maria Kanellis.
Like, okay, fine. If you want to do some little storyline with her and Mike, and that's fine. Whatever is whatever. But real talk, like, don't put a strap on her. Don't do that.
Don't put the strap on her.
That has so much
sadness in it.
Like, it does. Like, it pisses me off because, okay, she's real life pregnant, which means that now they have to come up with some erroneous way for her to drop the title without taking a bump. You know what I'm saying? Like,
then it's good. No, you're right though.
You should have just
now they have to find some whack way to do it. When they could have just not done it at all.
Yeah, or you could have just left the. I would have rather seen them leave the belt on Mike, and then have him use her as a human shield to prevent people from
exactly.
You know what I'm saying? I would rather see them do that to work her pregnancy into that angle than putting the strap on her.
That's literally what they did with the Miz and Maryse, and it worked. It was great.
Yeah, and then also not to mention the fact that you now are developing Mike Kanellis into an actual character. You're giving his character some personality, you know, which is something that they haven't done.
He isn't just one half of the Kanellis family anymore.
Right. Yeah, and so
no, like have you seen what he did when he was Mike Bennett in Ring of Honor? Like,
yeah.
No, he's a really good worker when you actually give the dude a chance.
Bro, I expected them to dominate 205 Live when he was down there. Like, I truly did.
Exactly.
I expected them to have a run and have him hold the championship. And when all of a sudden he just kind of dropped off the face of the earth and disappeared, and then they appeared back on Raw, I was like, oh, that's where he went. All right.
That's fine, too, I guess. Like, it's almost like they're wasting good indie talent again.
Yep. Pretty much.
Heartbreak.
It's the model of WWE. We get great, great individual talent. We do them great in NXT, and then we bring them up to the main roster, and we shit the bed with them.
Honestly, no. It's like, because I understand how it's like, you know. It's people in NXT, there's a lot smaller pool of a roster in NXT. They go from being a big fish in a little pond to just being a regular-sized fish in a massive pond.
Yes.
It's a lot to work with, and, you know, there's the idea that, you know, you can't push everybody at the end of the day, which is, that's completely fair and real.
Right.
But you have tag teams like AOP, and you have talents like Chad Gable, and they're wasting away. They're not doing anything. You're not giving them good undercard spots, at least.
They're being paid to do nothing. Until the next Battle
Honestly.
Royal comes up or some shit like that. I did hear that whatchamacallit is being repackaged down. The Fashion Police tag team is being repackaged down in NXT. I think they're still going to be the pack Fashion Police, but they're going to be they're going to have a slightly different package. So we'll see how that one works out.
Yeah, no, I think they're going to be taken a little bit more seriously. Did you see how that looked like? By the way, did you see Fandango is absolutely goddamn ripped now?
Really? No, I haven't seen him. I haven't seen him since I read this article.
Mm-mm, no, they gave him that good NXT juice. He's
nice.
Pumped now, dude.
like okay, a prime example. Now mind you, I was never that big on Mr. Derek Bateman in the first place. But y'all brought him back, pumped him up in NXT, and then have done with him since you promoted him to the main roster. The dude's literally been reduced to running around after the 24/7 title and getting beat down with chairs by Seth Rollins.
See, that's different to me. You know, where you have people like Drake Maverick and R-Truth who are really running with that.
Yeah.
EC3 looks downright miserable, and it's downright heartbreaking to see how it affects him, because he's outspoken about his disappointment.
Yeah,
and it's bordering to where like Ty Dillinger was before he left, and it's really sad to see that. Honestly,
you know what I would love to see though? You know what they really need to do, and I think this would be the greatest gimmick ever if they did this: bring back Damian Sandow, and have him run through all of his old gimmicks going after the 24/7 title. Like, every week he shows up on another show backstage as a different one of his gimmicks, trying to get the title.
That'd be perfect. Oh, man, I'd so be with that. Like, one week it's Damian Mizdow, and the next he's the macho man Dow, and, yeah. Oh, dude, that'd be perfect.
But, all right.
Oh, shit.
So, since we are on a limited time frame here, we'll kind of cut WWE off right there. They have not announced any title matches for either of their tag team champions, either the OC or New Day. So, hopefully those will be coming up this week. So I'm going to turn the floor over to you, my friend, because I have not had a chance to watch the New Japan G1 event. You have. So let us know. What's it been about?
All right. In my opinion, this is the best G1 I've ever, like, actively watched and followed. Mm-hmm. People are knocking it out of the park left and right, dude. Okada is in the lead right now in the A block, I believe. And then Jon Moxley, my boy, is at the top of the B block. There's a lot of really little small interweaving stories that they're really working with incredibly well. Okada is doing what Okada does. The man can fucking make a broomstick look good in a match if he tried hard enough. And he's doing exactly that. Everything he touches is turning to gold. Mwah. As IWGP champion, it became stale for a minute, but he's just pumping out good matches. Tomohiro Ishii is putting in bangers. I'm not joking. This dude is, like, bangers left and right, and it's great. Shingo Takagi, he had a really, really good showing in the Best of the Super Juniors. And at the end of it, he was like, I want to fight with the heavyweights in the G1. And they did so, and he's doing great. Ever since he joined LIJ, it's been wonderful, and they've been really running with him. Toru Yano is proving himself once again to be the most entertaining thing on the face of this earth. His whole gimmick of I'm not going to do anything other than cheat to win is somehow really, really entertaining. Mm. You would think it's getting stale at this point, but it's not at all. It's wonderful.
How many more?
There's a lot. Between August 4th, August 7th, and August 8th alone, between those two dates, that's about 15 matches in those 3 days alone already.
Okay.
That are lined up, plus the next few days coming after that. So there's a lot of matches coming up. Kenta, previously Hideo Itami, is back in. And
really? He's not in WWE? Wow.
No, he started in the G1. And In my honest opinion, I'm not too big a fan of the guy. I don't like him because his whole gimmick is, look, guys, I was good 15 years ago. But I'm not too big of a fan of him. But he had a really good match with the ace of the fucking planet, Hiroshi Tanahashi. Oh. He's done well enough, but somehow one of the shining stars that has come out so far is Lance Archer.
Okay.
Since Michael Elgin has taken a bit of his leeway, his yearly leeway from Japan, he's signed with Impact, if you haven't seen that.
Okay.
And he's been working a really good angle with the Machine Brian Cage, which I really liked.
Nice.
But usually around this time is where Michael Elgin would come in and he would play your typical American badass heel in the G1. You know, yeah. He would play your snotty American asshole and he would go around and do what they do. And because he's gone, Lance Archer has pretty well stepped into that position. And it's been really well. Being the big guy that he is, he's just tossing people around. He had a really good match with Will Ospreay where he really proved that. You know, he just tossed him around. It's like a fucking rag doll. It was nice. He started using the claw. If you remember that old wrestling move that isn't used too often, you know, where they clamp down on the sides of their head and they flip out like they're dying.
Yeah.
You know, they,
yeah.
You know, that really, really, really dorky move.
Yeah, only big guys use it, really. Like, I've seen Braun Strowman do it a couple of times, yeah.
Exactly. It's in my move. It's like one of the weakest moves next to like the heart punch.
Yeah.
But it's been used pretty well from Lance Archer. He started using it when they did a show in the South, and you know that's where that Von Erichs used it. So you know he got a really good cheap hop out of it.
Yeah.
Roll credits because Cheap Pop Podcast style.
Yep, yep. Sorry. Like, yeah,
but no, he started using that, and they're really selling it. You know, like. He clamps it down, and they act like they're going to fucking die from the claw.
Like he's crushing their soul.
No, yeah, they act like their temples are going to fucking explode out of their head. So they're really taking it, and I'm not too disappointed with it. I'm really, really impressed with his process, especially recognizing that he was in WWE in 2010, and he was doing absolute jack-all.
Who was
so it's really cool to see that kind of progress. He was Vance Archer.
Okay, okay. He was, I know what
yeah.
you're talking about.
Yeah. No, he had a really small role in the WWE CW.
Okay.
That's why you probably don't remember him because he was in that shit show.
Yeah.
Sonata in LIJ has really stepped into this role. He changed his look and everybody and their mom was instantly all eyes on this man. And he's done well with it. Kota Ibushi does what Kota Ibushi does and is damn near killing himself. Juice Robinson is really beginning to step into this role into the G1 of really becoming bigger than what he was after losing the United States Championship to Jon Moxley.
Right.
But I'm a bit biased as I talk about this because Jon Moxley is, honest to God, my number one favorite wrestler in the world. But God damn it, is he tearing it up?
Like, this is, let me say this. There have been a couple of guys post WWE that have had amazing careers. And the reason why I talk about it post WWE is because there's always this chip, this fight in their shoulder, on their shoulder that they want to prove that WWE was underutilizing them. And I think that's what's driving Moxley right now. And he's proving it every step of the way. That WWE completely underutilized him and what he was capable of doing.
No, yeah, it's clear that all of that is just pent-up rage, and goddamn is it working in his favor. The other day, he actually took his very first loss in New Japan. He was undefeated up until that point.
Really?
He was outright undefeated, and he took his first loss from the true ace, Toru Yano. But he took his first loss, and he reacted really well. And I don't know if you've seen it, but he has this really, really good angle working with one of the Young Lions. He's pretty much adopted one of the Young Lions, Shota Umino. He calls him Shooter. And he drags him around with him, and it's just this really weird, like, fatherly relationship where he occasionally, like, just says really mean shit because he's Jon Moxley. But it's golden because he walks to the ring and he's Jon Moxley, you know, barbed wire, screaming, flailing around like a madman. And he just has this little Japanese boy carrying his title right behind him all timidly. And after Jon Moxley faced his first loss, you know, he was hysterical, middle of the ring, wide-eyed, open-faced, like, you know, like how Booker T does it, just mouth wide open. And just little Shooter Umino poking at him like, you know, you good man? And it's golden. They're really running with this small little relationship they have with this young lion who previously was unknown, and it's golden. I'm loving it. Jon Moxley has been tearing it up left and right.
You can tell me, does it remind you of, because what you're talking about sounds similar to when, I forget who it was that was his apprentice, Matt Hardy, when he had, oh God, I can't remember, I can see.
Adam Cole.
Yeah, as his, when he was the V1. When he did the V1
game? Oh, no, never mind. No, yeah, never mind. No, I don't know. When you're talking about when he was in WWE really, really early on and he started becoming version one Matt Hardy and he had those two cronies with him.
Yeah, and I can't remember the guy's name. It was a little young blonde kid. But yeah, he used to carry his titles around and he was like his little sidekick.
Yeah, no, that's actually that's dead on how it is. And it's completely hilarious, dude. Because you know how Jon Moxley is. It's just... Perfect promos, everything like that. And he's it's golden. It's really funny material. If you can find videos of it online, do it on YouTube. 100% watch it.
I'm going to definitely have to do it.
In summation, like, the G1 is doing what the G1 does and presenting, in my opinion, the best wrestling on the face of this earth.
For sure.
I say this as somebody who's, like, adamantly, no, you know, not one of those Japan marks that'll sit here and tell you that Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks are the best thing on the face of this earth, and WWE is evil and terrible and, you know, too sweet me, bro. But no, but it honestly is the best wrestling on the planet. If you're looking for the top tier, right, outright banger matches, there's only one place to look, and it is the yearly G1. And G1 29 this year is fucking golden.
There you go. It is alpha approved, so y'all need to go out and check it out.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know I am.
The alpha seal of approval.
There you go. All right, so last thing we'll talk about is that an announcement. I wouldn't call it a big announcement, considering we've known it was coming for months now, but now we know the specific date. I believe they said October 2nd is when we will be seeing the new AEW TNT weekly show.
Mm-hmm.
Which actually a couple of matches have already been announced for it. It said that we're going to have Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks take on Chris Jericho and two mystery partners. Isn't that supposed to happen on the first episode?
Really quick, as a passing thought.
Yeah.
Because just to touch a little bit on the other combat sports that we don't talk about, Cain Velasquez, the UFC fighter.
Yes.
He's making his wrestling debut either tonight or tomorrow.
Really?
Yes, he's debuting for AAA at Triple Mania. I'm still watching it.
Nice.
But he's debuting alongside my personal favorite luchador right next to Pentagon Jr., Psycho Clown. Mwah, my boy.
So is he actually going to be wrestling, or is he just kind of like a valet to the ring?
No, he's going to be wrestling. It's going to be him, Psycho Clown, and Cody Rhodes versus three other guys.
Nice! That's the one thing I like about Impact, and I do like about AEW, is that they allow their talents to show up in other promotions. And work storylines in other promotions. That's just so amazing. Like, no offense to WWE. I understand what they're trying to do by keeping everything in-house. But when you allow people to do that, it just creates such great working relationships, and it's such a great thing for the fans.
Honestly. All right. I apologize. I just want to add that in as a passing thought. You can go ahead.
But yeah, so this weekly show will most likely go head to head with NXT. WWE has said that there's rumors in WWE that say that they may be moving NXT to actual live television instead of just on a network to compete with AEW. There was also another rumor that I hope isn't true, that they're going to start having a lot more main roster guys show up on NXT if they do bring it to natural TV to be able to help, you know, draw some interest in it. But I'm like, NXT itself as a product can draw enough interest on its own without having to bring in any main roster guys. They have a talented enough roster. But you know, WWE, they always got to go overboard when it comes to shit to try to make sure that they get it. It's like there's rumors that they're trying to get The Rock for the debut episode of SmackDown Live on Fox in October.
Yeah.
Trying to get The Rock to show up to draw more ratings. And I'm like, AEW is doing it with nothing but their roster as constructed, and I expect them to put on a hell of a show. But I do believe that, and I've been thinking about this a lot, I do believe that AEW is going to fall into a similar category as Impact Wrestling at its peak. Not that it won't be better than, but it's going to fall into a similar category. It will always have better in-ring work and better promo work than WWE. But I doubt it'll ever be bigger than WWE. It'll find its niche, and they'll be successful, but I doubt they'll ever be bigger than WWE. I doubt that AEW will garner the lion's share of viewers on any given night over WWE.
Whereas AEW is like this huge focus on just the wrestling itself, WWE is a corporate entity.
Yes. You know, and WWE's gotten really good at the entertainment side of it. Like, where they're lacking in whatchamacallit, they make up for it. Like, gimmicks like the 24/7 gimmick aren't much about in-ring wrestling. They're about the gimmick. You know, and it's one of the best gimmicks going in wrestling right now. Oh, shit. I loved it on Raw Reunion when Alexa Alundra Blaze won the 24/7 championship and then came out to throw it in the trash the same way she did the women's
the women's title at WCW 20 damn years ago.
You know, and I love the Million Dollar Man, but that man has made at least $1 million off of saying his one key catchphrase.
Honestly. Oh, did you hear the little factoid about that? Okay, so there's something really interesting about that I think you'd like to know, especially because you're really into the good 80s and 90s wrestling.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you remember correctly, Ted DiBiase, by technicality, never won the WWE Championship. He bought it from Andre the Giant, right? He bought it. So because of that, they never officially recognized his reign. They always said that it was never official, and by technicality, Ted DiBiase, the Million Dollar Man, was never WWE Champion. That's special because he just won the 24/7 title by buying it, right?
Right.
But they officially recognize that. So therefore, by technicality, 20 years after it's happened, he is confirmed WWE champion.
Yep. You have to give that to him now. Yep.
You have to
give him the 24/7 one. You have to give him the WWE championship because it was the exact same thing.
By technicality, it's official now.
Yep.
And, like, I thought about that, and it's like, damn, like, that shit was, that was 20 years of debate right there.
So giant round of applause for the Million Dollar Man for recognizing his first WWE and only WWE championship run recognized. They have to. They still say no, stop.
Exactly. All right, you can't take that away from them, though. All right, no, one last thing, though, before we go off, though. I want to do one last thought. Looking at wrestling, there's a lot of really new stars coming in, especially with everybody signing in different places and a lot of people moving to WWE. PWG and Ring of Honor lost a lot of really good people. But one of the biggest stars that I want to put a little bit of focus on and just give a little shout-out to while I'm here is Jungle Boy.
Okay.
If you haven't heard of him, he is the son of Luke Perry, the late great actor.
Okay. Really?
Like, Jungle
like,
Boy...
Like Dylan on 90210, no. Luke Perry?
Yes, that's his son.
Oh, okay.
No, yeah. And he is a really, really good wrestler. In my opinion, he has the chops to become the best high flyer in the business when he hits his peak.
Okay.
If you can, look up some of the stuff he does. He works in AEW. He does a lot of stuff in PWG. But the kid can fly. And goddamn can he work. So
right.
I just want to give a little shout-out to him, and if anybody has the time to check out what he's done, if you don't already, please do, because in my opinion I think that dude's going to be big. I can see it.
All right.
But I just want to add that in before we end off on the wrestling section and we end this. Thank you.
Well, yeah, no, shout out to Jungle Boy, but yeah, man, keep bringing those every week. Like, try to find somebody else that you would recommend, because his recommendations are always pretty good. I can tell you from experience.
Absolutely.
We've talked wrestling.
Absolutely, I can do that.
So, all right. So that's going to wrap up our inaugural episode, episode 00. We will be back again next week, talking more, probably like I said, giving our SummerSlam predictions, talking more pop culture, whatever the biggest news is coming. This is what we will be from here moving forward, guys. So I hope you are enjoying it. We will, of course, be evolving and adding segments and taking away segments and all of that. Like, what I will do is I will bring back an old segment starting next week that I used to do with Raw Impact Unleashed called Shout Out to the Indies, in which we'll find some of the hottest indie promotions going and kind of tell you where they're at and kind of give you some information on where you can go find local indie shows in your neighborhood, because we're all definitely about supporting the indies. Like for me, it's a selfish thing of I like watching guys come from the indies to the semi-pro level of like Impact, NXT, to the main roster level of AEW and WWE, and watch them grow as characters and watch them grow and develop their characters over time. So
downright
going to indie shows and seeing who the next crop of talent is going to be coming up. And one of these days,
perfect,
Alpha, I'm going to have to get you down to the Bay Area and get you over to a BTW show, a big-time wrestling show out there with a lot of those guys. You'd be surprised. APW and BTW out of the Bay Area, out of the Hayward, San Francisco area, has produced a lot of people that you've seen in NXT, in WWE, in Impact Wrestling, etc. Just a quick name drop before we go. Cheerleader Melissa. I don't know if you remember her from back in the day at Impact Wrestling. It was all, she also played Awesome Kong's manager for a little bit. Which, by the way, been watching Glow with my fiance. Did not know that, that Awesome Kong was in that. That the big girl.
Yo, did you see fucking Awesome Kong. Dude, if you watch that whole show, look, I'm gonna give you a real quick lineup. You're gonna see the sleazeball Joey Ryan on the show.
Yeah, I've already seen. You're gonna see
him. If you have you seen Alex Riley yet? Because he's there too.
Yes, I have.
And then fucking Carlito and Brodus Clay are brothers, dude. I'm sorry, but like, take my money.
Exactly. Oh man, like yeah, no, I was reading through. Well, what it was that it's ironic that you bring up the Joey Ryan one, because that was the one that got me looking into like what professional wrestlers were actually on Glow. Like, ironically, the guy, I don't know if you pay attention to just kind of crossing over here. Have you watched the most recent season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. or have you stopped watching?
I'm still catching up.
Okay.
I'm not on the most recent one though.
Yeah, okay. In the most recent season, the guy who plays Carlito and Brodus Clay's father plays on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Like, he plays a character
on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Like, it was funny because we got back to watching it and we rewatched the episode where he was on there, and I was like, hey, that's dude from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Okay, cool. But yeah.
Crossover episode.
Yeah. You know, but yeah, man, like, I went watching that. I looked at, when I saw the guy come on, I was like, my God, that looks like Joey Ryan. I was like, I am almost 100% sure that that's Joey Ryan. And so I went and research online and figured and found out that it was.
No, yeah, like, my mom was watching it. And she pulled me from my room and she was like, who is that guy? And I was instantly like, no, that's Joey Ryan. She was like, I know he's a wrestler, and I know that you know him because you know more than me. But like, who is he? And I was like, instantly, I've seen that mustache and that sunglasses anyway. That's fucking Joey Ryan. You cannot fool me.
And actually, the woman that's in the show, the one that plays his valet, is actually Joey Ryan's wife. In real life.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like that's the woman who he's with now. And yes, no, I had to look it up to figure out that that was Alex Riley, though. Like,
I didn't recognize him
right off the bat.
Oh, no, same, though. Wait, did you already stop recording?
No, we're still going.
Okay, cool. We can just edit that out then, but go on.
Oh, okay. I'll talk to you afterwards. I want to say, and then that's when I found out that the thick black woman in there is Awesome Kong, and wow, she's lost some weight.
Oh, you don't even know.
You know, and then I started looking up, and then that's when I confirmed for myself. I always figured that was Carlito, you know, but he looks a little different than even he looked when I met him in real life. So, of course, I knew Brodus Clay the moment he stepped on screen. Everybody knows.
Now, that man is instantly recognizable, yeah.
You know, so, but all right, so let's wrap it up. Any last words for the people?
No, that was perfect. Can't wait to see you all again. All
right, guys, so thanks for joining us. We'll catch you next week, and keep listening in for the Cheap Pops on the Cheap Pop Podcast. Peace.